So it's really nice to be here without actually having to wake up at 4 a.m. in the morning to do a hotfix release. So I'm actually I can follow my own thought pattern. So today I actually want to talk to you about some constructive things after yesterday's negative things. So for this, my talk will be a bit technical, but basically given its very nature. But I'm really hoping that you will see the simplicity despite the technicalities. So first up, a little perspective of go-ethereum and Ethereum in general. Basically, as you probably know, go-ethereum, C++ Ethereum, and Python Ethereum were one of the three origin clients. What this meant is that the clients kind of were already existing before the protocols evolved. This meant that the client, so the protocols, the peer-to-peer protocols, the consensus protocols were all specified based on the experiences learned from the clients. And what this meant is that the clients were kind of evolved like a startup. Just hack together code, hack together some other code, delete some code. So the code quality was really, really bad. Now, on top of this, when Ethereum was born, then there weren't any other tools. So now we have quite a lot of tools in the ecosystem. But with the birth of these three clients, the clients were required to do absolutely everything that that a developer would need. And even further, since we wanted to make Ethereum to be useful as much as possible for everyday developers, the idea was that we are going to provide a JavaScript environment because more or less everybody is familiar with JavaScript. And because of this, the problem became apparent that if you wanted to use go-ethereum or the Geth codebase or any other codebase as a library from your own project, not from a JavaScript DApp, it was extremely, extremely hard. And the reason was that the fast prototyping accumulated an extreme amount of technical debt. The networking, since Geth was kind of the network, had the network majority in the protocol, I mean, had the network majority, it was really hard to drop features. And every time you tried to drop something, somebody was using it hiddenly and was really, really angry at us. And furthermore, browsers, since we kind of targeted browser-based debt first, it was the emphasis was always placed on JavaScript. And it was really hard to somehow use it outside of this predefined JavaScript environment. So this was kind of our world until now. And if we fast forward to the present, one of our main features, as Jolt already mentioned, that we have Light Client, Swarm, and other stuff, but one of our main features for the Geth 1.5 release is kind of a brand new code API, so that actually any developer can use either go-ethereum as full or pieces, any little tiny piece that they want in their own project without actually having to use a command line interface. And why are these good? Well, for example, we try to take a look from different pain points, from the perspective of different pain points. One of them was that people don't really want to share their private keys with the node, especially if you're running multiple dApps against the same node. Why do you want to place the key in the node? Keep the key yourself. It's much safer that way. Or the other thing, that the RPC spec, although it's JSON RPC, it has this fancy hex encoding for quantities and other stuff that are really non-trivial. So to get them right, it's not such an easy thing. And although every developer will probably be able to do it, it's just a pain to do it yourselves. Now, if you actually want to interact with an Ethereum contract, Ethereum has its own ABI, the way to encode and decode function calls and parameters. And that is very, very complicated. So yes, it can be done, but it takes a ton of time. And possibly you don't really want to waste that time. You want to spend time developing your dApps, not implementing some protocol. And last but not least, there are certain cases where it's really natural that you don't want an external node. You want to be able to run your own node. For example, if you have a mobile app, then it kind of sounds weird that, OK, to use my app, please download this app, and this app. So the user will just say, no, let's not go there. And these were the pain points that we really tried to address in Geth 1.5. And so let's dive deep into the technicalities. So first of all, can client-side account management be done in a simple way? And our answer was that, yes, of course, it can be done. And the following code that you kind of see on the screen are four method calls and full account lifecycle management you can do fully client-side in your own code without actually having to run Geth, Parity, or any other client. You can basically create a new account. You can export that account into a JSON. You can take it wherever you want. You can import it back up. And yes, you can, of course, delete it. And all of this is done client-side without any backing Ethereum node. And that's actually the whole program that I just running there. So everything is full program. Nothing else is outside of it. And this is basically how we cleaned up the account management. So you can take the account manager, you can take your accounts, Ethereum, and take it everywhere you want. And you don't have to leave it inside Geth or any other node. You can just do it yourself. OK, now what happens? You can manage your own accounts. But another thing that you really want to do is, only with accounts, you can't do much. So you need a node to actually interact with. So the other, the second part that we spend quite a lot of time is to cleaning up the remote APIs. And for this, we also provided a really nice library. It's called the ETH client that can actually dial into any Ethereum client, either via IPC socket, HTTP, WebSocket. Basically, it's a full-fledged Ethereum client. And furthermore, it's not just a simple RPC client that you need to manually specify all the JSON RPC details. Rather, it's actually all the officially spec'd methods are available. So you can, for example, query the current block. So this basically this nil here is just saying that I want the current block and not any random block. I can for example also query the state. So previously that was querying the blockchain. I can query the state tries. This is just querying how much funds currently the Ethereum tip jar has, the foundation tip jar. And one more thing that's I'm not sure whether it was introduced in 1.4 or 1.5. But we actually do have subscriptions. So one of the problems with Mist during the DAO crowdfunding phase was it was hammering the underlying node with tens of thousands of requests per second, RPC requests. And the node was basically dying because it couldn't serve those requests. And the single problem was that the nodes didn't support push notifications. And that's also something that we kind of fixed. So now you can just, your Ethereum clients can simply call subscribe to new head events. And whenever a new block is mined, it will be immediately sent to you. And you don't have to do polling at all anymore. And of course, if we run that, again, that's all the code. It will tell me that my chain height is currently at 22 million or 2 million something. It told me that the tip jar has about 3,800 ethers. And as you can see, my laptop is actually connected to the mainnet now. And as the blocks are being mined on the mainnet, it is immediately pushing it to me. And again, the code is just the three function calls that you see on the screen. Full source code, you can see it on the screen. So basically, you can do chain exploration and state querying and everything via a few API calls, a few programmatic calls. You don't have to implement anything yourself. So OK, now if you have key management and you can interact with the remote node, you almost have everything. But if you actually want to interact with the contract, then you have a problem. And the problem is that your code needs to actually implement the Ethereum ABI. The ABI, as I said, is not trivial. The basics are kind of easy, but there are quite a lot of corner cases. For example, if you try to serialize or deserialize an array of structures in Web3.js, you will find many corner cases that aren't completely properly handled. And this many times people usually just say on the internet, well, just use ints. Well, yeah, but if Solidity supports all these other types, why not use them? And implementing them is kind of a nitty-gritty detail. There are quite a lot of details. So it would be really nice if we could have a library that does this automatically for us. Then, of course, if I want to interact with a contract, it would be nice if the library could also cover all the remote client API stuff, so I don't have to care about RPC at all. And last but not least, if I have an already existing contract and I just want to interface with it, OK, then cool. I can just create some code to access a few methods and I'm done. But what happens if I'm actually developing that contract? If I'm developing it, that often I'm just changing some Solidity lines. And the lines I change, I want them to immediately reflect in my code. And this is a really nasty part that I change Solidity, then I need to have to change my own code. And then I need to make sure that none of my tests broke. And it's really a long procedure. And when you want to update Solidity 10 times per minute, it doesn't really work out. So our solution to this problem was we created Abigan. Basically, it's a native binding generator. And what it does is that you can simply specify a Solidity contract, and it will generate you full Go source code. and you can just plug that Go source code into any project, and you will have immediately access to all the contract calls, all the transactions, all everything natively, and you don't have to care about any of the encoding or any of the RPC calls. And the really nice part about that is that if you rewrite your Solidity contract, then immediately it gets recompiled. I mean, the Go code gets regenerated, and if there's it's type checked, it's compile time type checked, you don't get surprises during actual deployment that, oops, something didn't work out. So how does, for example, this look? Well, if the top part, you can see a Solidity contract. Basically, it's a snippet from our release contract, the Geth release oracle. What it is that for every release, we kind of bump a version number on the blockchain. And then every time a Geth node starts up, it just checks this version on the blockchain. And if a newer version appears, then it just prints out a warning to the user that, hello, please update. And well, it does a bit of maintenance in the background, but essentially this single function is what is fetching the current version. And if you run through this, run this code through Ebigan, then it will give out about 400 lines of Go code that we didn't have to write ourselves. Of course, for the other functions too, in totaling up to 400 lines. And but it does give us a really nice API. It says there, basically, I have a new release oracle method that I can just point it to a contract. I can tell it how it can reach an Ethereum client that might be over HTTP, WebSocket, IPC, or actually an in-process client. And then I can just call that I want to get the current version. And it will just, if I run this, then you will see one of the nasty parts of one of our lazy sides is that we actually never updated the version for the yesterday's hotfix release. So oops, sorry about that. So the blockchain wasn't updated to the latest release. But basically, I could simply call a single command line function, single command line utility, and then I can immediately work with my contract. I don't have to write any boilerplate code myself. And then last but not least, one of the interesting things that you can also do is usually in this ecosystem, there has been a relatively little request to run in-process nodes. But there are quite a lot of cases where you genuinely do need to run an in-process node. For example, if I'm developing an application which isn't Ethereum-centered, rather Ethereum is just a utility in it, then I would like to distribute my application to clients or to any other people without asking them to first sync up an 80 gigabyte blockchain or just telling them to please download another app, whether that's one client or the other, it doesn't matter. I just want to distribute my app. Here's a single binary, you can run it, and it just works. And for that, we cleaned up our API so that API-wise, in the Go client, you can just create an empty peer-to-peer node. It's just a dev peer-to-peer implementation. You can attach any protocol, whether that's an official protocol to it or whether your own custom protocol. So you are free to implement your own protocols up top of dev peer-to-peer. And then it's just a way to register that I want to run the ETH service on top of that protocol. I just start up the stack, and I can attach it. So again, just four function calls for setting up an entire Ethereum node. And if I run that, now it is actually compiling, building the full Ethereum suite, which takes about, I don't know, 10 seconds, maybe a bit more with my power cable unplugged. So yes, that's another thing about Go, another nice thing. That was the full compilation of Go Ethereum. And yep, I just started it up in a new empty data directory and just queried some basic information about it. And as you can see, this again, as I emphasized with the previous release, with the previous slides, again, this is the full source code. So there's no other boilerplate that you actually need to write yourself. You can have a full in-process embedded node in three lines of code or four lines of code. Of course, I left out the error checking, so do keep that in mind. Okay, so if we have all these awesome libraries available, let's try to put a twist on them. What would it take maybe to allow supporting them on mobile platforms? Well, to tell you the truth, mobile platform was kind of already supported in 1.3. About last year in September, I did the first cross compilation to Android. It looked horrible, it performed horrible, but it actually worked, so I was really surprised. We did have to fix up a few things in our code base. But we could actually start up an Android debugger, just copy a binary, a CLI binary to an Android device and just run it, and it was running. It was really an amazing feeling. Of course, it was completely useless because you don't really run your Android programs by copying over a CLI binary and requiring actually a terminal to run it. So during the winter break, Christmas time, we started to play around with actually providing a library so that users can more easily interface go-ethereum in mobile apps. And if we did provide Android archives and we did provide iOS frameworks, but if we did provide all of these things, why aren't there any Ethereum mobile apps or any popular ones? Well, the kind of the answer is that that was our full API in the bottom line. So that was everything that we supported. So basically, we created a wrapper around the CLI interface, which is a horrible, horrible idea. But since we didn't have Light client and it wasn't even on the horizon, it didn't really make sense to put more effort into a mobile wrapper since nobody's going to use it anyway. So it was rather a proof of concept that people can start playing around with. It wasn't ever meant to be something to be released. However, of course, with 1.5 arriving, we want to change all this. So let's see how complicated will it be to actually run Geth as a library or parts of Geth inside mobile devices. And well, it turns out that we have exactly the same APIs that we had available in Go. We have that available in Android. We have the account manager, lifecycle management. It's exactly the same function calls. If somebody is a Java guru, he will immediately say that, ooh, that get.new is ugly. You should have only used new. Yes, we know that is a limitation bit of the Go Java bridge that will be fixed. But please bear with us until it is fixed. So basically, this was apart from a small Android boilerplate, this was the full code to actually do account management inside an Android application. And that's basically a screenshot from the application running in the simulator. So we have the same functions. We can add new accounts. We can export, import. We can delete them. So everything you would like to do with an account, you can do it. Now, OK, you might say that account management is pretty easy. You can do it with any fairly nice Java library. Why? What's the big deal? Well, let's go to remote APIs. Well, it turns out that with remote APIs, we can do exactly the same thing, like with Go Ethereum. We can create a new Ethereum client, which can attach to almost everything, HTTP, WebSocket, IPC interface, the same way as the native Go client could attach to it. And it supports all the same functions, plus it also supports subscriptions. Now, getting all of this working is a bit more involved, since you also have to implement the RPC interface. And you also have to implement subscriptions, which aren't exactly that trivial to do already. So push notifications, client-side handling them, it gets a tad messy. But you get that for free. OK, so we got account management and remote APIs. Let's see, can we interact with a contract? And the answer is sure. So actually, we extended Ebigan to be able to generate Java bindings to contracts. So the same way you had a Solidity contract and you could create a Go wrapper, you have a Solidity contract and you can create a Java wrapper around it. So basically, it just spits out a Java file. You just include it in the Android project, and bam, you can create a contract object and you can immediately call functions on them. No, basically, that's all that it takes to query the Geth version number from a mobile platform. And of course, last but not least, if you are running an Android app, then this is particularly the case where you don't want to depend on an external app. You want to run an in-process node. And yes, of course, we can run an in-process node where we can just similarly create a new node. If the API here is a bit simplified because it wasn't really a point to expose the entire Go API to creating nodes, it was more Ethereum specific. This might change a bit in the future. But in essence, we can create a node really simply. You can just specify a data directory, and voila, it's running. We can just start it up. And that's all. We can start it, stop it, interface with it, attach an Ethereum client to it, get all the data we want, interact with contracts, everything we can do with two lines of code, essentially. So that was the mobile platforms. OK, you might ask, what about iOS? Yeah, sure. It works. So the same thing, I don't expect you to read the code. I just pasted it if you look at the slides offline. But everything works really nicely. So just to sum the whole thing up, basically go-ethereum or go actually supports deploying on a variety of different platforms, Linux, Windows, OS X, the FreeBSD, on the all the platform, all the architectures that actually matter. And go-ethereum will provide pre-bundled libraries for Android and iOS for basically all the architectures that actually matter. As for Windows Phone, sorry, maybe in the distant future, there's not really an interest to port it. And if you are actually somebody who's interested in trying out either the Android or the iOS libraries, you are free to download them. Thank you very much.
Yay, thanks, Peter.